Good afternoon. Welcome, everybody, to this talk, this short talk about cyclomatic complexity. My name is Jeroen Resort. I'm a Java consultant at JDriven. It's a small consultancy company in the Netherlands. And let's first ask some questions. Who is using a code quality monitoring tool like SonarQube? Okay, that's a lot. Who is using that on a regular basis? Still a lot? No, that's good. Okay, so maybe you're already familiar with cyclomatic complexity. Well, maybe some details you're not entirely familiar with. Cyclomatic complexity was developed by Thomas McCabe in 1976. That's ages ago, a time when almost every programming language had a go-to statement. And his idea was by mathematical analysis, creating a graph of your code, calculating the amount of complexity that's in that code. Well, why should we use cyclomatic complexity? Well, the idea is you can measure the complexity of a piece of code, and therefore you'll be able to improve if you take measures to don't reach too much complexity, you'll be able to write more maintainable, more readable, more testable code. And it's you can say, well, a large piece of code is more complex than a small piece of code, so you could look at lines of code, for example, but cyclomatic complexity is does have value instead of just looking at the volume of your code. Okay, so how do we calculate cyclomatic complexity? I said it's a mathematical thing. You create a graph, and the complexity is the number of edges minus the number of nodes plus 2 times the number of connected components. Well, luckily, number of connected components is always 1 in a small piece of code you analyze. So that makes it edges minus nodes plus 2. There's a slightly alternative formula. If you connect the exit point of your code back to your entry point and you create like a cycle, then the formula changes to E edges minus nodes plus P, thus plus 1. And there is even a more simplified way to calculate it. Just draw that graph, connect the exit point to the entry point, and then count the holes in the graph to find out the complexity. We'll see that we'll look at a few examples. Okay, so how does such a graph look like? Every statement in your code is a little circle, and a node. And you connect those nodes with each other. So your complexity increases whenever you do some kind of branching, and these statements create branches. So if you do an if and else, the if is the one hand side and the else is the other hand side, and in the end they join up again. And as you can see, there are multiple ways to create branches. The case switch statement is one example that that you create a lot of complexity if you have multiple switch statements in your code. Okay, so this is an example from the McCabe paper. I don't know what code comes with it, but it's a big graph. You could count the number of nodes, 23, and count the number of edges. I don't know by my head, so you can count them if you want. It's more easy to just count the holes. So do we have a pointer? Yes. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So, but there's one missing. If you connect the end to the beginning, we create the 10th, and the complexity is 10. Like McCabe also calculated. So let's look at some code and try to calculate the complexity of this. Well, this is a fairly simple one to start with. So we have a start node. I'm very lucky we have a big screen so everyone can see how awfully I can draw. Okay, so, and then looking at the code, there was one statement. And then the code finishes with an end. Then we connect the end node with the start node. And we have one complexity. Rocket science. Okay, next one. Okay, and we start with an defining result, then a for loop, and then a result, then a statement in that for loop, and then returning. So let's try to draw that one. We have a starting point, the first statement, then the for loop, doing something repeatedly. Well, I believe it should be more like this. So, and then the final one. So this for loop can continue for a while, and in the end we finish. So the complexity is 1, 2. Okay, next one. So we have multiple if statements. Peek again. So if, so we can do either this or, what's this? My thick hands. Or we can do this and then continue. And then another one like this. And in the end, our code finishes. This one missing. So, complexity 1, 2, 3. You get the idea, right? So this is the same code, more or less, but then, what complexity does it have now? So we have one if statement, not two. But the interesting thing here is, the double ampersand, the right-hand side, only gets evaluated if the left-hand side is true. That means this is sort of a branch too. So when the left-hand side is true, then we continue to within the if statement. If the left-hand side is false, then we execute the right-hand side. If that's false, we continue. If that's true, then we continue inside the if statement. So, in the end, it's very similar to this. So, cannot undo more than that. So we have to start again. Sorry. The if statement. If the left-hand side is true, and then if the right-hand side is true, we execute this. But if the left-hand side is false, we go all the way here. And if the right-hand side is false, we also do this. So, the complexity still is 3. So the code has one less if statement, but the same complexity, the way it gets calculated. Okay, but there are some tricks to cheat on cyclomatic complexity. This one, for example, we create a boolean, then we do an operation and another operation and then return. There are no branches here, no if statements. So, how do we write this? It's just this one. Complexity of one. Is this more code easy? This code more easy to read than the other two? I disagree. So, cyclomatic complexity can be useful, but in sometimes you can create code that, according to the rules of calculation, it doesn't get a high complexity, but it's still sort of complexity built in. How to use cyclomatic complexity? You can look at the complexity per method, and if a method reaches beyond a certain level, example 10, then it's getting more complex, more hard to understand, also hard to test. So maybe that's a signal that you need to split up the method and make a separate smaller elements. It's not always possible. Sometimes it's just the way it works. For example, the large switch statement. Yeah, you cannot split that into separate methods. You can also look at complexity per class. That means if a class gets too large, it's an indication that you might have too many responsibilities in one class. You could look at making some separation there. Tools like SonarQube, they all calculate cyclomatic complexity a little bit different, not the exact formulas McCabe describes. For example, the return statements and the throw statements add complexity in the SonarQube calculation. So a return statement would mean you go from that statement to the end of the graph. The return statement itself would not add complexity. The if statement creating the branch does, but not the return statement also. So, but we generally agree that having multiple return statements in one method makes it more complex and harder to understand. So I can understand that they do count return and throw statements as adding complexity, but it's not by the definition of cyclomatic complexity. It's more complexity as perceived by a developer. Wrapping up, cyclomatic complexity can be a useful tool. If you're developing yourself, you can check if you're not making things too complex, or when you're reviewing someone else's code. But as I said, don't focus blindly on these metrics. Sometimes it just is, and you have to accept some complexity. But you can use it to find some hotspots in your code that might need some attention. And now you can see how you can calculate that complexity by hand. So be careful collecting those metrics. And if you have any questions, come over and discuss. Thank you for your time. My name is Jeroen Resort, and enjoy your conference.